say again, we're going to try to finish up the Mormon study this afternoon. And hopefully we can. We'll see. But anyway, all right. So number six, as far as Mormonism goes, one of the beliefs that we're covering so far is that Jesus Christ organized this world with the help of others under the direction of the Heavenly Father and the counsel of the gods. His helpers included Adam and perhaps Joseph Smith. That's what they said. So they teach the Mormon doctrine of creation is that a plurality of gods organized or created the world. Specifically, the Father directed Jesus Christ, called Jehovah, to organize the world from pre-existing material with the help of some of his spirit brothers. This is what they believe. And I'm going to quote a couple of their passages basically from the book of Abraham 4:1, which is from the Book of Mormon. And they went down at the beginning, and they, that is the gods, organized and formed the heavens and the earth. This is what they purport. And also in the teachings of the presidents of the church, and this was Joseph Smith, God created the earth as an organized sphere, but he certainly did not create in the sense of bringing into primal existence the ultimate elements of the materials of which the earth consists, for the elements are eternal. So what we see in this is that they believe that basically matter, what we see, is eternal. This would be the same argument that an evolutionist would use, that all of the elements that were necessary for the evolutionary process to take place and for the animals and the fish and humans eventually to come about was because that the elements were already there, they're eternal. Of course, this is not biblical. This is not, of course, what we teach or believe. And we get this, of course, we understand from the scriptures. And Genesis 1:1-2, very basic. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And the earth was formless and void, and darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the surface of the waters. So what we get from that is that the elements did not exist. God created the elements. You basically get the same truth taught in John chapter 1. In there, in verses 1 through 3, in the very beginning there, let me get there. All right, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through Him. And apart from Him, nothing came into being that has come into being. In other words, there was nothing. There was not anything for any quote-unquote gods to organize or to form or to make the world. It was God that created, and we know that the agent of creation was the Lord Jesus Christ. He made all that there was, actually spoke it into existence. There's a term that we used, this right here, ex nihilo, which means it was spoken out of nothing. Christ brought something out of nothing. And so this is the term that we use for that. So the doctrine that they speak concerning the creation of the world, that there were multiple agents of creation, basically we understand contradicts Scripture. It contradicts the truth of Scripture. This is why we believe that it is created by God. All that we see did not exist before He created it as so. And then you could go even to the book of Revelation when we see the praise there of the saints and those present in heaven. They give several different times in the scriptures. I'm just going to use one particular passage here. But they talk about giving praise for the creation in Revelation chapter 10. And there in verse 6. All right. And swore by Him who lives forever and ever, who created heaven and the things in it, and the earth and the things in it, and the sea and the things in it, that there will be delay no longer. So all that we see and all that we even don't see was created by God, which the Mormons, they contradict that. One more quote that I'll give to show that they believe that there was more than one agent in creation. Our great prince, Michael, known in mortality as Adam, they believe that Adam was Michael the archangel, stands next to Christ in the eternal plan of salvation and progression. It is true that Adam helped to form this earth. He labored with our Savior Jesus Christ. And so we can see how their doctrine specifically denies the truth of Scripture that we hold to regarding the creation of the world.
Right. They believe the Bible, our Bible, but they interpret it through the lens of the book of Mormon.
Well, and this is what we've talked about, it. I think we mentioned this last week, that they believe the Bible as far as it is interpreted correctly. And they believe that there are many parts of it that are not interpreted correctly.
God is not one in three persons.
Right. And so what they hold up first is the Book of Mormon. They believe it's infallible because it came from God the Father and God the Son to Joseph Smith directly. And so they believe that it is infallible. And then, of course, later on, they added the Doctrines and Covenants, the Pearl of Great Price. And then any of the presidents can also, are apostles also, or prophets, and that they can speak truth into existence. Whatever they speak, they hold as inspired by God. The next doctrine that they believe is Adam and Eve's act of eating the forbidden fruit was not a sin, but was a noble deed that was necessary for the blessing of the human race. So what they say, they say that the eating of the fruit of the tree, the knowledge of good and evil, was a transgression of God's command, but said it was necessary so that human beings could be mortal and reproduce. Okay? That they could live through a time of testing and emerge spiritually stronger with the potential to become like the Heavenly Father. So thus Adam and Eve were faced with two conflicting directives from God and chose the noble path that led to sin, suffering, and death for the eventual betterment and potential exaltation of the human race. Well, I started to say that sounds like a lot like some of the things that we heard this morning. Do what? Yeah. Right. It was necessary for sin to be introduced into the world.
The devil's also good then.
Do what?
The devil's also good then.
Well.
He led them to it. Right?
I guess that, I don't know that they would say that blatantly because they don't believe, but you'd almost have to come to that logical conclusion. Yes, Austin.
Did God make Satan?
Yes. Yes. His name was Lucifer. He was an angel, and then he fell. He rebelled against God. And then now we know him as Satan or the devil or Apollyon or the evil one. A lot of different names. He's got a lot of different. Do what? Beelzebub. That's right. That's right. Well, of course, and then let me read one more quote. The decision of Adam and Eve to eat the forbidden fruit was not a sin, as it is sometimes considered by other Christian churches. It was a transgression, an act that was formally prohibited but not inherently wrong. Adam and Eve could not keep both these commandments. If they chose to eat the fruit, they would be cast out of the Garden of Eden. But if they did not eat the fruit and remained in the garden, they would not be able to have children to multiply and replenish the earth. Now, there's a lot wrong with that statement, but the fact that it directly contradicts the Scripture, their assertion there is that if they did not sin, then Adam and Eve would not have been able to have children. That contradicts what the Scripture says in Genesis chapter 1 and verse 28. After they'd been created, before sin came, it says that God blessed them and God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the sky, and over every living thing that creeps on the earth." Do what?
Pre-fall.
Yeah. So they would have been able to have children. They would have had children. I'm convinced, of course, we know the plan of God is perfect, but that there would not have been pain with childbirth, and those things. And I I don't have to tell any of you women that have children about pain and childbirth. I might sympathize with your pain, but I'm not going to, pretend that I understand what that's like. But anyway, what they teach is directly contradictory to the Scriptures, what is written in the Word of God. Also, that this was some big favor, that this was not really a sin, but that there was a favor to mankind that they were doing. Well, in Genesis 2, in verses 16 and 17, it says, "And Yahweh God commanded the man, saying, from any tree of the garden you may surely eat, but from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat from it. For in the day that you eat from it, you will surely die." So this is directly from God to Adam. It was most definitely a sin. They were not doing anybody any favors, okay, by contradicting the command. And we could go to Romans chapter 5 where it talks there about the relationship of sin and death. But their sin here in being disobedient to God's command brought about sin and it brought about death. And so it was not some noble thing that they did. So it's definitely in this contrary to what the Scriptures teach. Okay? All right, the Heavenly Father. This is the next. This is number 8. Heavenly Father himself, an immortal physical man, sired the physical body of Jesus through his mortal mother Mary, so that Jesus became his literal only begotten son in the flesh when he was born on earth. Okay? It is Mormon belief that Jesus Christ is God's son in two distinct senses. First, he was the firstborn of Heavenly Father's billions of spirit sons in the preexistence. I think we talked about that last week where we talked about that they believe that there are billions of spirit children out there. All human beings are sons of God in this sense, though of course there can only be one firstborn, and this was Jesus. One of their prophets, their writing, it says, "Jesus was the only person to be born of a mortal mother, Mary, and an immortal father, God the Father. That is why Jesus is called the only begotten Son of God from his Father. He inherited divine powers from his mother. He inherited mortality and became subject to hunger, thirst, fatigue, pain, and death." And then another statement that they make, "Thus, God the Father became the literal father of Jesus Christ. Jesus is the only person on earth to be born of a mortal mother and an immortal father. That is why he is called the only begotten Son. He inherited divine powers from his Father." And so, this is what they teach. One more statement. This may be the most blatant of them. "I am bold to say to you, Jesus Christ is the Son of God in the most literal sense. The body in which he performed his mission in the flesh was sired by that same holy being we worship as God, our eternal Father." Listen to this. "He was not the son of Joseph, nor was he begotten by the Holy Ghost. He is the Son of the Eternal Father." Now, that again directly contradicts what the Scripture says about how that Jesus was conceived in Matthew chapter 1. Matthew chapter 1, there in verses 18 through 20. What we know from the Scriptures. "Now the birth of Jesus Christ was as follows. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Jesus before they came together, she was found to be with child," what? "By the Holy Spirit. And Joseph, her husband, being a righteous man and not wanting to disgrace her, planned to send her away secretly." So, not God the Father that sired him through Mary physically. We understand that the Holy Spirit conceived Christ in her womb. And that is how this contradicts Mormonism and the Mormon belief concerning that. There's some other scriptures we could go to. Luke 1 and 47. I'm going to read that one that speaks of the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. 1 and 47. And all her, wrong chapter. "And my spirit has rejoiced in God my Savior." This is what Mary said. So she was not some special mother. I mean, she was special in the fact that she was chosen by God to bear Christ, but not in the sense of what they say. She was a virgin and not sired by God the Father in a physical sense. Okay? All right, doctrine number 9. Salvation in the sense of immortal, glorified physical life is guaranteed for virtually all people, including those who reject Jesus Christ in this life, by Christ's suffering, death, and resurrection. Okay. Now, we touched on this somewhat last week. Somebody asked a question about the different levels of heaven or eternal life or immortality for the Mormons. So we touched on this already. They will affirm that Jesus Christ died on the cross and rose bodily from the grave, two important truths of Christianity. But it teaches that all human beings, including those who reject Jesus Christ in this life, will be raised from the dead with immortal physical bodies. They will then live in one of three glorious kingdoms forever. This is known as general salvation and applies to all people regardless of what they believe or how they behave. Okay? That contradicts the scripture which said it is appointed unto men once to die and then the judgment. And that narrow is the gate that leads to salvation and broad is the way that leads to destruction, intimating that there's going to be many that go into judgment, go into hell, which contradicts this particular passage of scripture here. But some of their teachings in a book called The Gospel Principles of the Mormons, because of his atonement, everyone born on this earth will be resurrected. This condition is called immortality. Through the atonement of Jesus Christ, everyone will be redeemed from the effects of the fall. All mankind will thus receive general salvation, excepting the sons of perdition. These sons of perdition, perhaps only a few in number, will be resurrected but will not be redeemed from the power of Satan. All other persons will be saved by the grace of God from death, hell, the devil, and endless torment. So this is what they regard there. This is what they teach. Let me see if I can find. There's different kingdoms. Let me say that once again, what it is as far as the names of the kingdoms. Yeah, the celestial kingdom, reserved for the wicked of the world. The terrestrial kingdom, reserved for honorable persons who did not accept Mormonism. And the celestial kingdom will be inhabited by Mormons only. So those are their levels of immortality and eternal life that they believe in. So, but we know from the scriptures, as we've already seen, that this is not the truth. This is not truth. Number 10, as far as their beliefs, although virtually everyone will be saved with immortality, only those who accept the LDS faith or Mormon faith and obey its requirements will be saved to eternal life in the presence of the Heavenly Father. According to Mormon belief, there's a difference between immortality, which virtually all people receive, whether they are good or bad, and eternal life, which only good people who accept the LDS gospel and keep all of its requirements can obtain. A person must accept the restored gospel, either in this life, because they believe that the gospel is not what we believe to be the gospel, but it is the Mormon teaching, the Mormon gospel. And so they must repent of their sins, obey the LDS churches or commandments, such as tithing, okay, in order to qualify for life in the highest of the three eternal kingdoms, known as the celestial kingdom. And to live in the highest degree of the celestial kingdom, one must also be married in a Mormon temple. Okay, this is what we believe. Here's another one of their statements. We believe that through the atonement, and this is in their Articles of Faith, we believe that through the atonement of Christ, all mankind may be saved by obedience to the laws and ordinances of the gospel. And then besides repentance, our works also include receiving ordinances, keeping covenants, and serving others. While these works are necessary for salvation, they aren't sufficient. Okay? So they deny, basically, the doctrine of justification by faith and salvation by grace alone. It was interesting to have a kind of conversation with Jake in the time that he was here. And the area that he lives in is very what we would call Arminian or Pelagian, believing that you can lose your salvation and that you somehow attain salvation through your works. And he said, I was preaching in a church one Sunday, and he said, just preaching on justification by faith alone. I guess I'm assuming he thought he was pretty safe in that. And said, a woman jumped up in the middle of the service and started screaming like she was possessed by a demon. So, this is a doctrine denied by the Mormons. They believe that your works are required for salvation. It denies Ephesians 2, 8 through 10, for by grace are you saved through faith. That is not of yourselves, not of works, lest any man should boast, you know. And so it denies that doctrine. And so, you know, Romans 3 also speaks of that doctrine. But how do you know, a cult? One of the ways you know a cult is they deny the core doctrines of the Christian church, the Orthodox church. Romans chapter 3, verse 24 and verse 28 there. In verse 24, being justified as a gift by his grace through the redemption which is in Christ Jesus. Verse 28, for we may maintain that a man is justified by faith apart from works of the law. So again, their core teachings directly contradict the core teachings of the Scriptures, what we know and believe to be God's teaching on salvation. Okay, so they contradict that. Number 11, Joseph Smith is the prophet of the Restoration. This is what they call the time of Mormonism after 1830. He's the prophet of the Restoration who did more for mankind's salvation than anyone besides Jesus Christ. Yes. Yeah. He, humble guy, very humble. He is highly esteemed in the Mormons, honored, praised as the man through whom God restored true Christianity on the earth. Although the Mormons do not worship Joseph Smith, he is adulated in LDS art and music, has a place in LDS religion comparable to that of Muhammad in Islam. And he dictated or rewrote nearly all of the LDS scriptures. He is described as having done more for this salvation than anyone else. It says in their Doctrine and Covenants, they say, Joseph Smith, the prophet and seer of the Lord, has done more, save Jesus only for the salvation of men in this world than any other man that ever lived in it. Nice to know. Above Apostle Paul. How about that? The day will come, and it is not far distant either, when the name of the prophet Joseph Smith will be coupled, wow, with the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Let that soak in. The Son of God as his representative, as his agent, whom he chose, ordained, and set apart to lay anew the foundations of the church of God in the world, and which is indeed the church of Jesus Christ, possessing all the powers of the gospel, all the rights and privileges, the authority of the holy priesthood, and every principle necessary to fit and qualify both the living and dead to inherit eternal life and to attain to exaltation the kingdom of God. No man can accept Jesus Christ as the Savior of the world. No man can accept this as his church, the church of Jesus Christ, unless he can accept Joseph Smith as God's mouthpiece and the restorer of his work in these latter days. Wow. So this is what, he tells us. I mean, this is what they believe. But what did Paul say over in Galatians chapter 1, verses 7 through 9? If any other man come to you and does not preach this gospel, does not preach this truth, he said, let him be accursed, anathema. Let the curse and the judgment of God be upon him. That's what he said. And again, he said, even if an angel from heaven comes, when this is exactly what Joseph Smith said, then he changed it, it was Jesus and God the Father. And preaching of the gospel to you, let him be accursed. So, this basically tells us from the scriptures that he was most definitely a false prophet. As we talked about this morning, about those that were used of Satan to preach false gospels, to attack the church of God, he was definitely one of those used of Satan to preach a false gospel and try to destroy the work of God. Okay? I mean, it's pretty bizarre stuff, just unbelievable stuff that people would actually believe this. All right, number 12. The Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints is the only true church. Shocker. and its priesthood and ordinances are necessary for entrance into God's presence in the celestial kingdom. Now, what they assert, according to LDS doctrine, is the only true church, and so the Christianity was apostate or fallen away between the 2nd century and 1830. So basically what they say is there was no true gospel and no true church for over 16 centuries, is what they assert. All other teachings, all other preachers, all other were false teachers. And so the church that we love and adhere to, they consider an apostate church. And they know this, as I said, as the restoration. They also, it says that non-Mormons, they say, non-Mormons lack the true, full, or restored gospel and are not authorized to preach the gospel. That was the one that I liked, called me a messenger of Satan. That, you know, any Protestant church has a preacher or teacher. If you don't preach LDS, you're a messenger of Satan. So that's what they would consider me. And they believe also, we talked about, I don't know if I touched on this before, but they believe in continuous revelation of the scriptures through their presidents. They believe in continuing apostles, but their doctrine here basically denies the statement of Christ that I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. That means continual building of the church from the time of Jesus Christ until he returns again. Well, they deny that. They say that somehow the true church and the true gospel got lost during this time. Basically what they said, it says one by one the apostles were killed or otherwise taken from the earth because of wickedness and apostasy. The apostolic authority and priesthood keys were also taken from the earth. The organization that Jesus Christ had established no longer existed. Confusion resulted. More and more error crept into church doctrine. And soon the dissolution of the church was complete. And the period of time when the church no longer existed on earth is called the Great Apostasy. And so this is what they believe happened. That's what they think happened. And so Joseph Smith proclaims when he comes up with the Book of Mormon that now the true church has restarted again. It's been restored. And that they are the only true church. This is one of the marks of a cult, is they will say, unless you belong to our church or unless you're baptized in our church, you are not going to go to heaven. You're not going to be. Now, they don't say that. They basically, we're going to have some sort of immortal life, but we won't go to the celestial kingdom unless you're a part of their church. So, and then the last point I'm going to cover, faithful Mormons, this is a biggie, may become gods, meaning that they can become all-powerful beings that make and rule their own worlds. A lot of people don't know that. They believe that this is one of their, I guess you call it an attractive belief. People, hey, I get to be a god. I get to have my own world. I think I made the statement last week about, but only the males get to be gods. And the females get to bear all sorts of spirit children, you know, on this world. But it holds out this ideal that human beings who were God's literal spirit children in heaven may become like their heavenly Father in every way, that is, they may become gods. And they use the big G. They don't use little g in that. One of their statements in their what they call the gospel fundamentals, which it's anything but gospel fundamentals, says to live in the highest part of the celestial kingdom is called exaltation or eternal life. To be able to live in this part of the celestial kingdom, people must have been married in the temple, must have kept the sacred promises they made in the temple. They will receive everything our Father in heaven has and will become like him. They will even be able to have spirit children and make new worlds for them to live on and do all the things our Father in heaven has done. People who are not married in the temple may live in other parts of the celestial kingdom, but they will not be exalted. So, how does this contradict Scripture? Well, the Scripture is very plainly There's a multitude of scriptures. I'll use a couple of them from the Psalms. Psalm 83, verse 18. That they may know that you alone, your name is Yahweh, are the Most High over all the earth. You alone. You alone. Psalm 148, verse 13. Psalm 148, verse 13. Get to that. Okay. Let them praise the name of Yahweh, for his name alone is set on high. His splendor is above earth and heaven. Okay. And then Isaiah chapter 37 and verse 16. O Yahweh of hosts, the God of Israel, who is enthroned above the cherubim, you are the God, definite article, you alone of all the kingdoms of the earth, you have made heaven and earth. So all of those scriptures profoundly contradict what they believe and teach and say. And so those are you know, the main doctrine. That certainly is not all of what they believe, but that gives you an idea about how far away from the truth that they are in all of these things. There were some other things, other topics, other things that they believe. Jesus, as a polygamist, was wed to Mary and Martha, they believe, the sisters of Lazarus, and to Mary Magdalene. The miracle of turning water into wine, the Mormons claim, was performed at his own marriage feast. What they believe about that, yeah. A seeker who asks God if Joseph Smith is a prophet will receive a burning in the bosom. that's where, you know, and if you receive that, then you'll know that he was a true prophet of God. Protestant churches comprise the whore of Revelation 17, and their pastors are agents of Satan. Okay. That's what they believe. Jesus will return to Zion, Missouri, the location of the original Garden of Eden. Well, I don't remember that the Tigris and Euphrates come out of Zion, come out of Missouri, maybe the Mississippi, I'm not sure, but to reign for 1,000 years. Adam, before coming to earth, was none other than Michael the archangel. The second death is reserved for Satan, demons, and all unrepentant sons of perdition. All temple sealed Mormons wear specially marked undergarments, which supposedly keep them from being harmed. Okay. And then it says, odd, I found this odd. Oh, worship service, okay, guys. Worship services are not conducted in Mormon temples. And then last, I like this one. The Constitution of the United States is a divinely inspired document. The U.S. government will collapse. The Mormon apostles will rescue the Constitution and save America. And the LDS president will become the new leader of the USA. Okay. Those are some of the other stuff that they believe. Okay.
Brother, if I can add one thing.
Yes, sir. He is.
To deliver. And I read testimonies where the Holy Spirit worked and they, you know, the veil was lifted, they were able to see the truth and come to the saving grace of Christ.
Yeah. And then
saw the errors in the Mormon religion.
Right.
So,
okay.
Amen.
And this, you know, the teaching on this illustrates the fact of how that Satan moves against the true church and his true bride. And it's going to continue to do that. He's not going to leave he's not going to leave believers alone. There's going to always be persecution. We've seen it throughout history for the 2,000 years. We've seen that. They persecuted Jesus. They persecuted the apostles. They persecuted the early church. They've been persecuting the church forever. And so this is just another kind of a sideways attack where they just kind of introduce enough what quote unquote Christian doctrine or Bible doctrine in with theirs to turn. turn people away from the true gospel, I think. And certainly people that don't have the Holy Spirit that are not believers, some of this might sound attractive. Now, to me, it just all sounds nuts. But anyway. Yes, Paul. Well, okay, I mentioned something about this last week. You know, they have these history rooms and things like that. Why they trace their lineage, that was primarily what the information I had, is that it says 98% of that is so that they can trace their lineage, their ancestors that were born before 1830 and didn't have a chance to believe all the Mormon doctrines, and so then they can be baptized for their dead relatives. Yeah, somewhat. I didn't really get into that, but yeah. Right.
But in Utah, they have all these records that don't exist anywhere else. I don't think I've made that up.
Yeah. Well, it is. I mean, it's all the made-up stuff. They also believe that Jesus came up here to the Native Americans. Right.
They've got that thing as well. So I'm assuming what they're doing with Zion being in Missouri, like their temple is the actual temple. I mean, they call it the Mormon temple. I'm assuming
right.
The one in Salt Lake, is that the temple?
That's the temple.
That's the temple.
That's the
where Joseph Smith said it would be built, but we don't need to get into that again.
Yeah.
The temple's not where they're coming back now.
Right. The temple is in Salt Lake City.
Yeah, okay.
So that's the temple, but they don't have another one in Zion?
I don't, you know what? I don't know the answer to that question. There's probably one there. Well, actually, he was killed. That was in Longview, Illinois, is where he died. Sure. I'll get right to him about it. I'm trying to go without making any references to the chosen or all the, okay. Any of that. Okay. Any other comments, questions? All right. Let's dismiss in prayer. Well, Heavenly Father, Lord, our heart aches for all of these people that are deceived by a false gospel. And they are lost and headed down the broad way to destruction. Father, I thank you that you've revealed truth to us. But Lord, help us to have a heart of compassion for those that do not know you. But for the grace of God, we could be of that number. So Father, we ask, help us to be bold, truthful, and gracious in our proclamation of the truth concerning salvation. Lord, I thank you for your people that have gathered today. Thank you for the fellowship that we've had one with another. I pray, Father, through this week, daily, that we will seek your face, that we will pray for one another, that we will pray for those of our friends and loved ones that don't know Christ and speak to them in a wise way as we have opportunity. Thank you, Father, for this day, and thank you for your goodness and your blessings on our